Holding true time here at Ecclesia Bible Fellowship, a place for you to belong. A pleasant good evening to you all, and thank you for being here. We're coming to you live from 32 Hope Road at the Liberty Academy. Find us here every Friday at 6 p.m. To you, our online peeps, our online crew, whether you're on Facebook Live or YouTube Live, welcome to Unfolding Truth. Thank you for being here. We enjoy studying with you week by week by week. And if it is your first time here, welcome. And I am sure you will enjoy our program tonight. We're starting Luke chapter 19 for this week. Our speakers tonight are Pastor Hall and Elder Damian Williams. I am excited to start, and I hope that you are too. Let us get right into the word. But first, let us start off with our usual praise and worship. Thank you all for being here.
And you have called us to be your peculiar people. We thank you for privilege. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your word that we come here today to learn more of you. So we pray, Father God, feed us as only you can, to your glory and to your honor, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening. And welcome again as we continue with our book, our study, God's Word. We're still in the book of Luke. We begin chapter 19 as we wrap up chapter 18. Final observations and inquiry as to whether or not it was said, and if it was said, if you grasp it. But as usual, we start with a recall of what you learned last week that was transpired. What impacted you? What caused you to stop and take a look? So, right now, the invitation is open. It's open to those online. It's open to those YouTube, Facebook, and wherever you are listening, it's open for you to do your reflection. So go ahead.
Last week would have looked at the passage of the blind man receiving his sight. And it was basically to point to the fact that even though the people who were around Jesus at the time could identify him as Jesus of Nazareth, because this blind man could identify him as Jesus, as the son of David, it was demonstrative of his faith. And because of that, he was healed. We had also diverted to speak about worship. And during my, I guess you could say, daily studies, I found an excerpt that I just wanted to share. This is not from me. This is from a speaker by the name of John MacArthur. I watch sermons when I'm at home to inform myself.
We're not hearing that.
An excerpt from my studies I wanted to share with you guys. Not original, it's from a speaker by the name of J. MacArthur.
It has anything to do with the passage?
It has to do with what we spoke about last week.
Okay.
So all of scripture is God's self-disclosure. So according to the word of God, we worship him. And for many years, people have suggested that worship is some activity other than preaching. And I've been asked, with such long sermons, how much time do your people have to worship? And my response has always been, without long sermons, they don't know how to worship. Your worship is informed by your understanding of the revelation. Your worship only goes up as high as it goes down, because the deeper you go into the truth about God is the higher you go in worship. Superficial knowledge of God is superficial worship, and then people need to be manipulated to worship. Worship, by the way, is not music. Worship is loving God. Worship is honoring God, knowing him for who he is, adoring him, obeying him as a way of life. And music is just one way to express that adoration.
Why am I nervous?
What happened? Didn't make too much sense? Huh? Okay. Worship is, a big part of worship is music and singing. Try to get you guys to understand that. You look at the Psalms, you look at the sojourn with Israel, even coming out of Egypt. You look at them climbing into the hills to the temple. Worship and music is big in worship. Singing is big in worship because it's an expression of your adoration of God and his character. So we can't try to lift up one side of worship, which is the word, and drop down the other side at his expense. They are both important. Can't have one without the other.
Good evening. What resonated with me last week was when you spoke about the Lord's will. So it doesn't matter how earnest your prayer or prayers are. If it isn't the Lord's will, then it won't happen. Because like presently for the past couple of months, I've been praying earnestly about a situation and it's just not happening. And I'm like, oh, so they must have God, you forget me. and it's just not happening. So last week when, you know, when I heard you said that, you know, it's the Lord's will, I mean, everything just fell into place, fell into perspective, and I'm like, okay. So in the past,
yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. So, you know, you say, boy, if it's the Lord's will, you will talk and say if it's the Lord's will. But sometimes it just doesn't connect. But last week, how you spoke about it, it just resonated with me. When I'm going home, I said, Gio, you hear that? Because Gio is also praying too. And I said, Gio, it's not that the Lord isn't hearing our prayer, no, but is it his will? So I took that away from Bible study last week.
Okay. And come the others who have to share. Just go. We were here last week. Those who were here last week. It was just two persons here last week. Somehow the room did seem full to me. Don't know. Troy, you were here last week, weren't you? Yeah, long time we don't hear from you. Sure, what spoke to you last week? You can't say that.
What spoke the most to me last week was, Israel said it. It was the blind man who heard that Jesus Christ was passing by. His faith, however, God revealed himself, or the knowledge that Jesus Christ is actually the Messiah. And he was actually being told to shut up. And what was remarkable to me was that the Bible said that he cried all the more. And Jesus Christ, knowing what was going on with him, called him and said, what do you want me to do for you? And he said that I may regain my sight. And I remember that it was pointed out that this man could see before. He could see before, so
he... Well, you know that?
Regain.
Okay.
He asked that he could regain his sight, and Jesus Christ said, your faith has made you well. So that is what really stood out to me, that it actually ties in with faith come by hearing and hearing by the word of God.
Okay. Two things. First thing is, God answers prayer in several ways. Yes, it must line up with his will. But sometimes it's not just no, sometimes it's wait. All right? So don't go crossing the top and say, boy, we don't answer because God is going to give me out of here already. Even if you're earnestly, desperately praying, you are supposed to be resigned to his will. And part of his will is in the right time. God never works outside of his timing. Never. And nothing we do can get him to work faster. The Bible says of Jesus that at the right time, God did what? Sent forth his son. When? At the right time. When was Jesus promised? From way back in Genesis 3, Jesus was promised, seed of the woman. Now was the time when he came. So God works in his own time, and part of us relinquishing our will to his is at his right time.
I think Tell me when you're ready.
It's good.
This, okay. I think very often when we talk about answers, prayers, we always look at the outcome as God's answer. And sometimes the wait doesn't come with the outcome. Sometimes the wait is the answer. And in the wait, we recognize that what we were praying for is not what we wanted, because now our will is being conformed to His. And sometimes the outcome we recognize, Luke chapter 11, we just passed it, that when we pray for bread, He would not give us stone. When we ask for fish, egg, He would not give us a serpent. Sometimes we're praying for that thing, and He knows that's not the thing that we need. And so as we wait, Luke, we read about the persistent woman in prayer. As we wait and consistently in prayer, we realize that our hearts are being changed and conformed to His will. Right? So sometimes it will do us really great, even when we pray for the thing, to not focus on the outcome, but what God is doing in us as we persist in prayer. Yeah? Because sometimes that is your biggest blessing. What He does in you more than what He does for you.
Any? I want to check. Comment on the blind man.
This mic is not on.
They keep interfering with it.
Check, 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 check. This is a good lesson in being prepared, isn't it? Because if we check the mics before we bring them up, we won't have this problem. So, lesson for everybody, when Jesus says, be prepared for you don't know what hour that He's coming. And you're not ready because, and He comes and you turn on your mic and boom, no sound. All right, be prepared. Listen to our technicians. All right. We talked about the blind man, and there were some things that I wanted to make clear. I'm almost sure I said it, but just in case I didn't, I want to reiterate. When Jesus said to him, your faith has, what? Made you what? Jesus was not talking about faith for him to have sight. Did I not say that last week? Oh, but everybody looks surprised here this week. You know, we tend to always attach faith to things like that. What will you have me to do? Is a question that requires what kind of understanding? Come now. Say it, make her hear it. You can say it from where you're sitting. If I ask you, what would you have me to do? What does that require? Yes, it means that you are required to have confidence that whatever you ask, I can do. You get it? Yes, it's lined up and tied up into what he called him. Remember what he called him? That Troy and Israel went over it. Son of David, what that meant again? Yes, it's a messianic title, which meant that he recognized him as God. And so when Jesus comes and says, what would you have me do? It is not because Jesus is trying to inquire what he really wants help with. After all, Jesus is all-knowing, is he not? So Jesus would have known what he was calling for in the first place. A lot of what Jesus did was not lessons that was applicable immediately to the persons that he was dealing with, but for the crowd. This crowd. Because this crowd more than likely going go away and saying, well, the blind man believed God for healing for his eyes. No. Not what he asked him. Nor did Jesus respond that you went get back your sight. Did you see that? I almost said it might not work, but this must be my ears. You know? He's saying to him, what do you think I can do? And he expressed that in terms of what? His blindness. For only God could give him back his sight. And he says, restore my sight. Give it back to me. And Jesus' response is, your faith has made you whole. So, if you apply that to sight, what in fact you are saying is that if you can't see, you're not a whole person. Jesus is not applying that. Because his faith was demonstrated in an expression as he cried out to Jesus, Son of David. We talked about this last week. Have mercy on me. We talked about that too, didn't we? Only God can have mercy. Mercy is the prerogative of mercy is the prerogative of? I need you to respond when I'm talking. Because oftentimes it is through that response that you remember anything. Oftentimes. So when you sit back and you keep quiet, you miss it. Or it doesn't log in properly. Romans chapter 9. We quoted that last week. You remember? When God says, I will have on whom I will have mercy and harden whom I will. So God declared himself to be the one that dispenses mercy. This blind man obviously knows this. We talked about how he moved from the different levels of faith, and blindness was also a level of faith. Here's a man who couldn't see physically, but could see very well spiritually. You saw that? He knew who Jesus was. The others was falling for fish and bread, and the entertainment side of things, and the excitement of things, and the teachings, them was just there. He cried out to him, knowing full well who he was, And Jesus said to him, "What will you have me do?" Which is clear. Jesus is testing, how far is your faith? Since you're crying out, are you crying out like the others? Clamoring for something? A demonstration of his faith. Just like the woman with the issue of blood. A demonstration of her faith was what? A demonstration of her faith was what? Yes. Enough for say nothing. Enough for say nothing. I just need to touch him. And I will be cleansed. Just like the centurion. Demonstration of his faith was what? Don't have to come. Hey, listen, guys. This is Sunday school question. I'm sitting on and looking at me like I'm lost. And we have been through this already. So the application of faith manifests itself in the demonstration of what he said. But with all of his desire, there is the leaning on God's purpose and will when he says, "What will you have me do? Give me back my sight." What if Jesus said no? Would he still be the son of David? Yeah. Hmm? Yeah. How come some of us won't turn back when we don't get answers to our prayers? How come so many of us won't give up and call it quits when we ask God for something and we don't get it same time? You know what? They're not this God thing no more. And too many of us are being groomed to believe that that is a demonstration of faith. It's not. Somebody mentioned the last week, I think, about the Hebrew boys. You remember that? Hello? Do you remember that? Where they mentioned the Hebrew boys, that their faith was that he could heal, but even if he didn't choose to heal, wouldn't matter. It wouldn't change anything with them. Same thing. So I thought I had said that, but I know I needed to reemphasize that. His faith made him whole. Whole speaks to his position salvifically. Salvation. It's a reference to that.
Hello. I don't know if it's a good time to get an answer to this question, but you had referenced it. You said Romans 9, "I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will harden whose heart whom I choose to harden." Mm-hmm. I think I need clarity still. I think I came here probably a few months ago and asked the same question. I don't remember. And it's probably forget. I don't know. But concerning the hardening of the heart, can you tell me if I'm explaining it correctly? Because I'm not sure. In the Old Testament, when God is speaking to the prophets, like through the prophets rather, he says things along the lines of, "I will basically give them over to their sin," right? Is hardening of the heart kind of like that, in a sense where the Lord, they weren't going to choose God anyways, right? They weren't going to do that. No one chooses God. God chooses who?
Right.
I see. This is the part. God chooses who he wants to save, right? So then what is the hardening of the heart again? I know that do I have a part in that? Meaning, is it me refusing to relinquish my, like, relinquish control to God and recognizing that He's the Father? Is that the part that I play in it? And then what does it look like when it says that God hardens hearts? Because I know that God doesn't turn anyone away from Him, meaning God doesn't say, oh, you know, well, you're damn, God doesn't damn anyone to hell, you know. So I think I'm just a bit confused, and I would love some illumination.
I thought you had enough light on you down there. Since you want more, you want to tackle it or you want?
The hardening of the heart and appreciation of God's mercy. In the same Romans chapter 9, in the hardening of the heart, God references what He did with
Pharaoh.
And one of the things that we see God doing is with Pharaoh, allowing Pharaoh to be feared. Allowing Pharaoh as a man whose heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked to follow that kind of passion and inclination of his heart. And that is why as believers, we are called to guard this.
Right.
Because this thing, if we trust in it and allow it to have its way, leads us down that.
The hardened heart, right.
Right. There is also a sense in which
we understand through scripture God's sovereignty when He talks about the heart of the king is like the heart of the king is like channels of rivers, and God directs it in whichever direction He wants to accomplish His will.
Okay.
Yeah. And I think when we see God working in ways that allow people, and Romans answer that, to follow their own heart, we say, but God is unfair. And Romans says, who are you, O
man?
Man, to answer to God in this kind of way, because God's sovereignty allows Him to do what He wants.
Right.
I think when we talk about hardened hearts, we think, we start from the vantage point of people being good and people being this free agent to choose good and evil. But all people start out at
horrible, wicked, evil,
and condemned,
right.
And against God, and enemies, and hearts hardened against God because of what sin has done.
Right, our sin nature.
Yes.
Yeah.
So when we talk about hardening heart, is not you starting from this point of view. It's a kind of comparative speech in God's elective process of salvation. So hardened heart is almost comparative to what God does in having mercy.
Okay.
That's like one way to see it.
Like hate, like the hate thingy, if you don't hate, it's a kind of comparative thought to focus on that which is positive.
Okay.
That's one way to see it.
Okay.
And it's plausible. But I believe hardening is a little bit more than that. Yes, I agree. You start out already hardened. That's where Pharaoh was. And what started to happen to Pharaoh is that with the repeated confrontations with God, Pharaoh now got to the place where he started to soften. He was going to let them go because he realized that this one is bigger than he is. He's more powerful. Remember the magicians? Magicians came to him and said to him, we don't have the answer for this. But he remained hard. He got to the place when things got really bad. where he was at the place where he was willing to let them go. And the Bible says that God hardened his heart. What does that mean? That God caused him not to want to let them go. That's tough, and one of the hard sayings of scripture. And some people will jump at that right away and say, but I prefer that one, and that's fine. But then you have to answer the question. What does God mean when he says of Judas, who walked with the 12, who lived with Jesus? What does God mean when he says to him, better you never born? But in other verses he says, for this purpose he was born.
To come
it means that the mercy of God will never cause them to respond to him. It means that nothing that they have, it is God withdrawn mercy. So they can't respond. And why would God do that? That don't seem fair. Is it? You're thinking it, so you may as well shake your head and say yes. It does seem fair, but you see, as Paul says, it's not a matter about what appears fair to you. It is about God's sovereignty to act in any way that he chooses to act.
We say the same thing of our, and I'm using it because you're an attorney, of our legal system, right? That when people are guilty, we say they should spend the time. You do the crime, you should do the time. And in your judicial system, you have something that says if the person pleads guilty, they get shorter sentence time.
Right.
But there's also something that happens where people's sentences can be commuted. In the justice system, we may not see this as fair, we cuss all the time, but the legal system allows for it, true or false?
True.
Then God is just, and his justice demands that sin's consequence is death. But in his justice system, sentences can be commuted, and it is his prerogative to do so.
Yeah, man. That's enough of marinated.
I hear the
analogy. All analogies break down.
Yeah.
And
how
commuted.
Right. You understand how in the legal system you do have caveats, and we do not. We trust a fallible legal system with all of its caveats. And that's the point that I'm getting to. And if we trust a fallible system with all of these caveats, how much more a perfect,
right, an infallible God,
just
perfect God,
system that says this is how it is. Everybody is condemned. Everybody in this system is condemned.
Guilty.
Because of their guilt.
Yeah.
However, I am choosing to acquit you. The question is not why not acquit the others. It's
why acquit
you.
Right.
Why acquit me? Because what? We all are guilty.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. We're having a good sign tonight. We need more chairs.
Thank
That's
you.
Excellent. I want somebody, because we have taught this so often, somebody to attempt to go up there and explain election in 2 minutes or less. Come on. You have heard it so often.
From my understanding, election is God's predestination of a chosen race of people to bear the name of his son out of his love, seeing as we couldn't do anything to earn a right standing with God. And our election, quote unquote, is just being chosen to be in the body of Christ.
Now, but where would that leave us? Because we are not a race of people. We are not a race of people. God no longer calls a race. God calls individuals. Where would that leave the people in the church election? If we go by that definition, that God chooses a race of people. No, no, make somebody else answer it. Not you, but
there's no simplification of it, but let me try to explain it. The world is condemned because of sin. So God gave his son so that whoever believeth in him should not perish but and have everlasting life. Nobody choose, because we were all dead in our trespass. Nobody desired God. So God selected some. And that is the election.
Okay. Based on what?
Just based on him being God and him the sovereign, him choose who he wants to choose.
Okay.
So it's not anything that we would have done. It's not our good deeds or anything. Damien being Damien, you being you, right? It is just God choosing even before the foundation of the earth.
Need some more chairs. Need some more chairs. Not too many, but a few more chairs. Isn't this wonderful? Yeah. We just need to add some more. Going back every night, eh? So till we can't hold here and have to have Bible study twice Friday evening. Yeah.
So it's God's sovereign choice in selecting people for salvation. So regardless of, well, prior to their conversion, prior to any good works or anything, God's sovereign decree before the foundation of the earth to choose people for salvation.
Why is he choosing them? Are they not guilty of
yes.
sin? Are they not deserving of death too? So why is he choosing them? Next person.
Oh, I should answer.
No, I want somebody else to answer that.
He's choosing them because that's his prerogative.
Oh, no, 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 no. Then he would be, what happens to the death sentence? Okay, that's what I want. What happened to the death sentence? Yes, we are all guilty, condemned to die, and there is no eliminating of sin. You are condemned to death, you have to die. Go on. Oh, yeah.
Jesus took care of the death sentence. He paid it in full.
Okay, paid it for who?
Paid it for who? Yes.
Oh. All right. So Jesus' death was for everyone. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Right? So is that...
So that means everybody going to get saved?
No, that's not what it means.
What it mean then?
Because everybody now is dead in their trespasses and in their sins. They cannot respond to what God did through Jesus. Right? Now, as a result of that, God sovereignly choose those who are being saved to
who
accept Jesus.
Who are those Jesus. That are being saved?
The elect.
Who are the elect?
What do you mean by who are the elect? Those whom he choose from the foundation of the world to be saved.
Those who are being saved and getting theological. You see, when people go to school for 2 weeks, what's what happened? God moves and he selects a few.
Yes.
Their sentence is not communed.
Repeat that.
Their sentence has to be paid.
Yes, it was.
It is what we call what?
Atonement.
No.
Or propitiation?
No.
What are you talking about?
Substitution. Somebody said
substitutionary atonement.
It doesn't use it.
But no. That's what I said, atonement.
No. It's called substitutionary atonement.
Okay.
Don't.
All right.
Don't get it twisted.
All right, sir. We won't get it twisted.
Substitutionary atonement.
Yes.
It means that God substitutes the atonement of Christ on your behalf so that you are not declared guilty anymore, but declared just. Using the legal terms. Is somebody righteous and go to the court, they are not let off on the basis of their righteousness, but on the fact that they are declared just. No longer or is not guilty of the charges laid against them. That results in them being in right standing, which is what we call righteousness. We good? What basis did he choose? This basis. Well, I'm going to pick Sarah and pick Howard, pick Troy,
and pick.
And here's the basis. The Bible tells us the basis is that before we could do right or wrong, God, it started that way when he demonstrated his choice of two boys, twins. Yes, and he selected one before they could do anything so that it cannot be said that it's on the basis of their works that they were chosen, but on the basis of him choosing. Romans 9 and the first couple of verses tells us that. Yes, I suspect that Mr. Lady Mandir is on the phone.
Well, there's quite a few persons. So we have Avril on Facebook answering the question. So she says, the biblical doctrine of election teaches that God chooses to save some. And if he doesn't choose everyone, then there are some who are passed over. He chooses based on his own purposes and his desire to show grace to undeserving sinners.
You see, but Avril, you could have did come and get the prize, but you're online, you see. But I suspect that them take too long to see you, right? So I blame them.
Right. And on YouTube, quite a few questions.
From quite a few people or just Lovell Burke?
Well, we have from two people, but there are some comments from other persons as well.
Okay.
So from Lovell, he's asking, when the Hebrew says God hardened Pharaoh's heart, is this pointing to something like clay, or should the Hebrew mean God strengthened Pharaoh's heart?
No. Hardened don't mean strengthened at all. Pharaoh never had a bad heart. Where in the Bible does it say that? Hardened mean that he caused Pharaoh to be unresponsive to anything, but continue to defy God. That's what hardened mean.
Right.
Yeah. I know that is, what you call it? What you call them theologians? Liberal theology. The school from liberal theology who teach about hardened in the sense of clay. No. It means that God caused the Pharaoh. At the time when Pharaoh was about to break and give in, God said to him, no, I don't done yet. And caused him to resist even more. Now, why did God not finish there, sir? Why did God continue? If you read the story, you see it. Who is Pharaoh? Who is Pharaoh? A god of Egypt. Pharaoh was considered a god of Egypt. The plagues, what were the plagues against?
The gods.
All the gods of Egypt. So the final removal was Pharaoh himself. When he removed the Pharaoh that would come next, and then removed the sitting Pharaoh, there was no continuation of the line. And people now had to contend with their humanity and fallibility, and of course them is not God, because right now there is no Pharaoh existing at the time. God wiped them out. So, no, it is not like clay being hardened, only in the sense that you could say, boy, when clay well hard, it can take two legs, or it resists water. Mm.
All right, there's a question now from Garfield Robinson.
Yeah.
Is someone guilty before they are born? Did God decree that the person goes to hell before he sinned?
God don't decree that anybody goes to hell. The Bible makes that very clear, because for you to say that God decreed to get to hell, then we could always say that Jesus didn't come but came to condemn, just like the Bible says. Condemn, didn't send his son in the world to condemn the world. Why? The world was already condemned. We are born in sin and shaped in iniquity. So from the moment of conception, where a man takes unto himself the form of man, our child, our humanity, from that happens, the sin of Adam passes on instantly. In sin did my mother conceive me. And it didn't, that's right, it didn't mean that she was fornicating, that's why it happened. No, no, no. In sin. So from the moment that he's becoming human, and we have all regards for that, from that egg is fertilized, it is humanity. It is humanity. And if you start thinking like that, sooner or later you're going to tell me there's an age of innocence.
You know what fascinates me whenever we're grappling with this issue of election and God's move on the heart of people, either to or not to, how we always tend to bring charge against God when we're discussing this topic. I think what's fascinating for me is that God is able to be in control of the heart of not just those who don't respond, but those who do respond, gives me such confidence in the salvation that he's given me, that he is able to keep me from falling even when my heart wants to move in a direction that he doesn't want me. Because this grace and the mercy that he's given me is irresistible. It gives me confidence in him, in the salvation he's given me. So when I sing about, I've got a sweet salvation, and it's beautiful, I know what that salvation means. Rather than talking, or Paul talks about that, why are you getting into this argument about if God fair or not? Are you not seeing the richness in God's sovereignty in choosing you and his power to keep you because of his sovereign choice? And he makes reference of the twins, because if we look at the twins, the one chosen seems to be the one who walked a life that was disadvantaged in the physical. But that was his sovereign choice. And in his sovereign choice, he's able to keep you. He's able to keep your feet from slipping. He's able to keep your heart in the face of adversity and trials. Those things can get you to fall away. Because in his sovereign choice, you've been appointed. So when we get to Peter, he talks about an appointment, and he talks about something that is reserved.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's it.
What is our response to this choice?
you.
Right. So there's a conversation. So Leroy is responding as well to Garfield. But Garfield asks two questions as well. What were the boys, meaning Jacob and Esau, chosen to do? Were they chosen to salvation? In that text, the older was chosen to serve the younger. And then he asks, when did God determine who goes to hell or heaven?
Come on. The Bible says that before the foundation of the earth, God made the selection. In that very passage of Romans 9, he makes that clear again. He says, before them could do anything. So it was not based on service. It was based on who God determined that would carry on the lineage of this nation that he has chosen. That is where your nation thing come from. It's applicable Israel. It is in the Old Testament that God selected a nation. Didn't mean that he didn't select anyone else, but he selected a nation who would be the example and who would tell of him, who would represent him. So from the very onset, you know, God didn't... Just go back and look at the birth of Esau and Jacob. Go back and how did Esau and Jacob come about? How did they come about? Who was their daddy? Isaac. How did Isaac come about? Yes, miraculously, that's it. Abraham had nothing to do with it. God used Abraham and caused Abraham to be able. The Bible says it, a dead womb. Sarah is an old woman in her 90s. Abraham is 100. And they're having a baby. And it is because God is from the very onset teaching this nation that they ought to depend on him and not find strength in their own selves. Same thing when you read the book of Judges. Same thing when they wanted to do things. Quite a number of times you hear God saying, hey, too many of you. I don't want someone to say, go back next year, come back and tell them about you, do it by your own strength. It is a dependency on God to deliver, to carry out. See, and he wanted them to understand that. They could achieve nothing in and of themselves. The Bible says, before God created the world, he chose us. And this has nothing, the election there has nothing to do with carrying out a task. It has to do with salvation. And the context of Romans 9 makes that very clear. So, all right. You, what happened to Leroy? What happened? Him don't count. Leroy said something. You just went dismiss him like that.
No, all right. Leroy said a lot of things.
All right, don't read all of them.
In answering Garfield, he says, we are all born in sin because of our connection to Adam. We are condemned already, therefore we need redemption. Babies are nice and cuddly, but we are born separated from God. He also says, sin is our nature. It is our spiritual state. Even before humans can walk or talk, they already have the nature to sin.
And humans are born, we have the nature to sin. We are. That's what David is saying. In mm-hmm. sin was I conceived.
Right. Oh, okay. There's a new question that came up from Lovell. He says, how does James 2:26 fit in the perspective of the narrative of the blind man?
What does James 2:26 says?
It says, for just as the body without the spirit is dead, so also faith without works is dead.
How does it fit?
The narrative of the blind man.
But faith without, that's two different things. James not talking about works that leads to salvation, but works that are the result of salvation. So that the works there don't fit into that. All right. So now that we have left the pathway that took us down this journey, let us get back to our reading. If there are no more questions, are there any more questions? Because deal with it as it comes. But, you know, by now you should have been well rehearsed in the doctrine of election. I see certain people with a notepad saying to them, say, boy, if I didn't know it's nice, I come long time. All right, where are we? We are at chapter 19. Somebody want to read 1 to 10?
Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see Jesus. He wanted to see who Jesus was. But because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back 4 times the amount. Jesus said to him, today, salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost.
So one man couldn't see because he was blind, and the other man couldn't see because he was short. Funny how Luke juxtaposes those against each other. He entered Jericho. Jericho was considered the Beverly Hills of the time, wealthy and rich city. And he was passing through. And there was a man called by the name of Zacchaeus. Now the word Zacchaeus, let me tell you what Zacchaeus means. Zacchaeus means several things, all of them nice, clean, innocent, pure, or righteous. That's what the name Zacchaeus meant. But the task that Zacchaeus had was nothing that was clean, righteous, pure, or innocent. Besides Matthew, Zacchaeus is the only other tax collector named in the Bible. Only have a tax collector. And Zacchaeus was chief collector of taxes. Chief collector of taxes. He was a commissioner of taxes. That's what Zacchaeus' job was. And the Bible says he was rich. He was rich. Now, this is a rich city. This is uptown. And it is evident this is where Zacchaeus lived. This wealth was a part of him being able to live there. Tradition. You have a lot of traditional sayings. And tradition says that later on, this very Zacchaeus would be appointed by Peter to be bishop of Caesarea. We don't know about that. That's just a traditional saying, right? But Zacchaeus was chief tax collector. His wealth didn't come because the job was high paying. His wealth came primarily because of the benefits. His salary might not have been high, but the benefits were outstanding. Because the tax collectors were known to take more than was required. So if the tax was 10%, they made it 11 and 12, more like 14. Why? Because then they had to take it into Zacchaeus, who went take another 2. So Zacchaeus' wealth came or was accumulated because he scraped off for himself. And they had to scrape off enough so that he could get, and Rome was not going to be satisfied with less than what they ought to get. So Zacchaeus' wealth came by that. Zacchaeus was hated. Hated. Why? Because he's a tax collector. Let me see the hands of those here who have good, are good friends with tax any tax collector. It's good people to know, you know. You should try and fight some. You're going to need them help sometime or the other. Tax collecting now is not the same like then. It wasn't left up to the individual to collect what they wanted and bring in what should the government must have. But it is more organized. Then it was left up to them to bring in. Rome appointed them, or the governor appointed them. They brought in the tax. And when they brought in the tax for Rome, you know, Rome must get what it must get. And so the tax that came, even the governor had to get his slice off it too. So you see why they were hated so much. Are you complaining about a third? Is that we pay a third of a tax? I thought we had some people who did finance here. Is it a third we pay for tax? I'm asking you, Maureen, who appointed me to? Phoebe, what Phoebe say? You need what? Oh, Aisha, what Aisha is saying? That's why you need to use the mic, you know, because when you don't use the mic, we don't hear what is being said.
Saying that when you look at the pay stub and all of the deductions come out, it's roughly about 33%.
Yeah, tax was heavy. It was heavy, but necessary then as it is necessary now. Can't have a country that runs without taxation. I noticed that they sent you to be hung out to dry, Aisha, because we have you surrounded by two persons who finances their thing. And they didn't choose to answer or even give you something to concretize what you're saying. Left you, hung you out and left you to dry. Yeah. So, here's Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was seen as a traitor also. Why was he a traitor? Because he's Jewish. And as a Jew, his other Jews saw him as betraying the cause. Why? They were resistant to paying taxes to Rome because that is acknowledging that they were subservient and subject to Rome and its government. And so he was well hated. I don't know what Zacchaeus was doing out there without his security detail. But he was out there, and he was not able to see, and he was short. And being not able to see, being short, Zacchaeus was not one who could say to somebody in front of him, excuse me, I can't get us, I just get to see, because nobody was going to make him see. Yeah, not doing it. So Zacchaeus heard that Jesus was coming. Heard that Jesus was coming. Here's the distinction, the subtle distinction that Luke makes. One man couldn't see, because he was blind, but he knew who Jesus was. One man could see, but was short. He wanted to see who Jesus was. Two distinctions. Yes. Yes?
Yeah, why did you say Zacchaeus was Jew, was a Jew?
Because he is.
Why? Because of the tax collector?
Yes. No, tax collector? The passage said. And besides which, it was Jews who collected from Jews. Not Romans who did that. That was menial work for the centurions. They would not do that. And, when we go down to verse 9, we'll see. So Zacchaeus now tries to see Jesus, and the best thing he could do was race down where the crowd don't gather yet and see if he could get a pole position. But his stature would have caused them to just stand and block him or push him out of the way. So Zacchaeus climbs a tree. Where is the best vantage point in seeing Jesus? Zacchaeus had no intention of crying out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Zacchaeus was there out of intrigue. Just wanted to see what the excitement was about. That's why Zacchaeus was there. Zacchaeus didn't go to seek help from Jesus. Zacchaeus never went for anything like that. Heard about Jesus. And what would Zacchaeus have heard? He would have heard of Jesus giving sight to the blind. He would have heard of the many miracles of Jesus, plus the feeding of the 5,000. He would have heard of Jesus being a master teacher. What he probably would not have heard about Jesus was that he was indeed God, the Son of David. And even if Zacchaeus heard that, it would have been difficult for him to process that. Especially being Zacchaeus was also an outcast. Why? Zacchaeus could not go and worship in the temple. Why couldn't Zacchaeus go and worship in the temple? It was unclean. So the laws of the land were stacked against him. Not of the land, but of the religious sect. And the people were stacked against Zacchaeus. Isn't it funny that we're going to see that in a little while, if we finish tonight, that the people who need Jesus the most are the people we try to lock out the most. Did I just say that? Isn't it funny? Yes. That we do that even to this day. There's an ant crawling on these glasses. What? We, because I'm part of the church. So even when it's false, if I disagree with it, I'm still part of the church. Don't mean I agree with what we do, but I'm part of the church. When I go outside there, I can't say I'm part of that church that don't believe in this and don't believe in this and don't believe in that and do this. I'm part of the church. You see? So that's why the we. So, here's Zacchaeus. Rejected because of what he did. Rejected because of how people viewed him. Rejected by both sinners and the religious. And I make the point again that the church so often are not those that welcome the outcasts, but stand as part of those who make the outcasts. Hello? Where we establish rules as to who should come and who shouldn't come. Where we set up standards that, boy, you shouldn't be talking to this And you shouldn't be talking to that, and you shouldn't be talking to. And Jesus demonstrates the exact opposite. He walks down, all knowing Jesus. Didn't see Zacchaeus because Zacchaeus called to him. Didn't see Zacchaeus because Zacchaeus was on a branch that hung down in front of him and he couldn't help but see him. But was purposeful about seeing Zacchaeus. Oh, we know that. Because of his response to Zacchaeus. He sees Zacchaeus and he says what? Come down. Hurry. Because today I'm going to have supper with you. I'm telling you, if Jesus lived today and walked in today's world, he would have been treated in the same way that he was treated then. People would have looked on with scorn and contempt, and they would say the same thing that they said then. They began to grumble, saying, he has gone to be the guest of a man who is a sinner. Gone to be the guest of a man who is a sinner. This is not the first, the second, the third time that Jesus is accused of this. It was for this very reason why they brought the lady caught in adultery. Why? Because, see, we catch him here now. He declares himself to be the Son of God. But the Bible says he must be what? She must be what? Anybody caught in adultery must be what? Stoned to death. That's the requirement for them. So if he says he's the Son of God, and it is God who gives us the law, then he would have to stand with us. But how is he going to stand with us and continue to offer mercy and grace and friendship to these that are like that? Same sort of accusation, same reason why they brought the lady before him. Yes?
Just want to compound the point very quickly. If Jesus Christ were here, we would treat him the exact same way, because his people are here now and they suffer with him the exact same way he did when he was here.
Yeah, so what?
We, as the believers, suffer with Christ the same way he used to suffer back then. No. So, yeah. It was just to add another perspective to what you had said about if he was here, he'd still be suffering. He is here in us, and we still suffer for him.
No, but we're not suffering in the same way. People not accusing us because too often we're not doing it. That's the point that I'm making. Christians today are not seeking to speak to sinners, but have put them into isolation. Look how we talk about people when they appear to be different coming here. We treat them differently, don't we? Tell the truth and shame the devil. Of course we treat them differently. Of course we have a lot to say about them. Of course we want to show that we are not like them. Of course we want to impose rules and regulations on them. Jesus went to Zacchaeus as he was, because Zacchaeus was incapable of changing himself. So we now somehow have got the message to come as you are. We say that. You know that? We say that. Come as you are. And when they come, we tell them, all right, all right, all right, no further than right, dear soul. You have a change first. You have a change first. Jesus was never that way responsive. And that was part of what affected Zacchaeus when he saw the response of Jesus to him. Here is somebody who would be considered a part of the righteous system that didn't respond to him in the way that the righteous system was responding to him. Because he could not go to the temple. And here, the one what the temple is all about comes to Zacchaeus, comes to his house. And Zacchaeus, verse 8, stopped and said to the Lord, "Behold, Lord, half of my possession I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will give back four times as much." Zacchaeus' restitution was far beyond that which was required. Far beyond that was required. If somebody robbed somebody deliberately, well, you're going to have to rob deliberately, but was deliberately violent to them. Rob them, probably beat them up, or mash up things. Then according to Exodus 22, verse 1, they had to make restitution four times the amount of the value of whatever they robbed and whatever was destroyed. If they were, it was just a robbery. Where them just hold up and take away, or they just break and steal. Where the goods couldn't be returned, so them sell it. Then Exodus 22 verse 4 says they would have to pay twice the amount. And if they voluntarily confessed and was voluntarily making restitution, then they would just have to offer the value of the things and or plus one-fifth of it. So the value plus one-fifth. Laws that were written down. Leviticus 6, verse 5. Numbers 5, verse 7. But Zacchaeus determined to do far more than the law demanded. And this is where we leave off. We will complete this next week. And we want to thank those online, those who had questions and were participating tonight. We were happy to have you. We'll be more happy to have you here if you want to come. We have space to the back. We're kind of full, but we have space to the back. God bless you and see you on Sunday morning. This Sunday, we have one service. Those who join us on a Sunday morning, we have what time?
9 o'clock,
because we have a meeting with the church right after. So everybody needs to come to that meeting, right? Everybody. It's not going to be broadcast online. It's not going to send out Zoom links. You need to be here, all right? For certain individuals that are members of the church abroad, we will send a Zoom link for you. Remember that, Amir. Zoom link for certain people. People like an Avril, like Jackie, like some are, you know, those people who are abroad, and Roxine, who is that? Joy, people like those who are always, you know, they're still a part of us being abroad. They come to church, they come to Bible study. We will send out links to them. Otherwise, so that means it's not pasted in Word of God Speak, because Word of God Speak does not have just members. This is a business meeting. All right? God bless you. See you on Sunday.
I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now. You are Jireh, you are enough. Jireh, you are enough. And I will be content in every circumstance. You are Jireh, you are enough. You're forever enough, always enough, more than enough. You're forever enough, you're always enough, you're more than enough. I'm already loved, I'm already chosen. I know who I am, I know what you've spoken. I'm already loved, more than I can imagine. And that is enough. I'm already loved, I'm already chosen. I know who I am, I know what you've spoken. I'm already loved, more than I could imagine. And that is enough.